morning, everyone, and welcome to the Worship of God with McClure United Church this morning. We are so grateful that you are joining in for this time of virtual worship. Today, we acknowledge two very important celebrations, Father's Day and National Indigenous Peoples Day. So a big shout out and happy Father's Day to everyone who fills the role of dad, biological dads, adopted dads, foster dads, dad-like dads. Whoever you are, thank you. Thank you for sharing yourself. Thank you for sharing your love and leadership. Thank you for being you and for sharing that you with others. I also think it's important to acknowledge that today is not an easy day for many. There are those among us who are struggling today, for whom today brings up a feeling of grief, of loss, maybe anger, maybe even fear. So I want you to know that I understand your grief, and I am sending to you love and prayers on this day. Today is also National Indigenous Peoples Day. Now I'll be sharing more about that with you a little later on in the service. So it's important to always remember and acknowledge the history, the rich culture and gifts of the Indigenous people of Canada. But today is a day designated to publicly celebrate these contributions. So with this in mind, we take a moment now to acknowledge that many of us watching this morning are living on Treaty 6 territory, homeland of the Métis. And so here is a Saskatchewan treaty map, and I invite you to just take a second to find yourself on that map. If you're not from Saskatchewan, find the land that you can acknowledge this morning. Acknowledge that land, acknowledge the land on which you live, and may we live with respect on this land and live in peace and friendship with its people. Alrighty, so I do have a couple of announcements this morning. This coming Friday will be the last of our virtual coffee gatherings for the summer, but we are going to experiment with a face-to-face gathering beginning Friday, July the 3rd at 10 a.m. So here's how that's going to work in a way that will keep us safe. Important details for you to know right now is that we will be gathering outside in the church parking lot. There will be a maximum of 20 people, which means that you will need to let me know by the end of day on Thursday whether you are planning on joining. So everyone needs to bring their own chair and their own coffee. We're not allowed at this point to serve common coffee or snacks. So if you do not have a chair that you can bring, that's fine. I will have a few of the plastic chairs from McClure available, and I will have sanitized those ahead of time and will sanitize them again once we are finished. Chairs will, of course, be spaced out to respect appropriate physical distancing. So I know, friends, that this is not ideal. We'd all love to be shaking hands and hugging and sharing together in a great big carrot cake. But this is a step, and we are going to make the best of what we have and what we can do in this moment. So if you're interested in trying this out and coming to the gathering, please let me know so I can reserve a spot for you. There will be more information about this as well posted on our Facebook page and our website. Okay, and so as previously mentioned, there's a task group that's been established, and they're diligently exploring all of the possibilities for reopening. They don't have an easy job as information is changing daily. And our facility is a bit more complicated than some, given our close proximity to so many who are in the more at risk category. And we really want to ensure as much as possible the safety of our community and all the people that we love. So please have patience, and we promise that we will share information with you as soon as it is available. And finally, next Sunday will be Brian's last Sunday with us as his appointment comes to an end. So there are a group of folks who are working together to put a little virtual farewell for Brian to be shared during our worship next Sunday, but they need your help. So you are invited to consider taking a short video of yourself, of your family, your household, your group, completing this sentence. I would like Brian to know that. All right, it does not have to be professionally done. You don't need to worry about getting your hair cut. Just send in your greetings so that we can share those with Brian. And you can email your clip to Andrew, and his email address is communications@McClureUnitedChurch.org. And email those into him by Thursday, June 25th. If you're unable to share a video or you just don't want to, you are invited to share your farewell comments in the comment section beneath next Sunday's video on Facebook or YouTube, or you can just do it the old-fashioned way and send in a message of thanks in a note or a card, and you can just send those to the church address or put them in the mailbox outside the main entrance doors, and we will be sure to get those to Brian. And I believe that's it for our announcements this morning. So now let's ground ourselves here in God's love and open our hearts to the light of Christ shining in and through us. Light this candle. And let us pray. Loving and gracious God, thank you once again for gathering us together. Draw us near to you now, and may we feel your presence surround us as your love fills our hearts and your peace fills our minds. Help us, God, to remember and hold on to the truth that while we worship in separate spaces, we are still joined together as one community, worshiping together, united by our love and desire to follow Jesus. And it is from this understanding that we offer ourselves now to you in worship. Amen.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, longing for their Lord, for God's coming kingdom shall be theirs. Blessed are the sorrowing, for they shall be consoled, and the meek shall come to rule the world. Lead me, Lord, lead me, Lord, by the light of truth, to seek and to find the narrow way. Be my way, be my truth, be my life, my Lord.
So as I mentioned earlier, today is National Indigenous Peoples Day. For the last several years, some of us from McClure United Church have joined others from across the city for the Walk for Reconciliation. It happens on this day, June 21st of each year. And it has been such a powerful experience to participate in this journey together, to walk together, and then to celebrate the diverse Indigenous culture through song and dance and storytelling. There is often a festival after the walk, and it is incredibly inspiring to be a part of all of that together with others. So I want to show you now a little news clip from Global TV highlighting this year's events honoring this very important day. So featured in this video is Amy Sasiquisis from the Office of the Treaty Commissioner. I invite you to watch this video now, and please watch it right through to the end. This has important information about the events of today, but also some information for us about why this is an important day to celebrate.
And today, set aside each year to recognize and celebrate the unique heritage and diverse culture and outstanding contributions of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. June 21st is National Indigenous Peoples Day. Amy Sasiquisis is the Director of Education with the Office of Treaty Commissioner. She joins us ahead of this very special upcoming day. Good morning, Amy.
Hi, good morning, Chris.
Thank you for joining us this morning. I really appreciate you stopping by. I'm hoping you can start out by talking about the meaning behind National Indigenous Peoples Day in a general sense, but also more specifically about what it means to you.
Well, we've been celebrating this day in Canada since 1982, when the National Indian Brotherhood, now known as the Assembly of First Nations, called upon the federal government for a day of recognition at a national level. And so this day is to recognize and honor the histories, cultures, languages, the resiliency, the achievements, and the contributions of Indigenous peoples in Canada. Indigenous Peoples Day means to me is a day for my identity to be recognized and honored, and a day to celebrate that with other Canadians.
Amy, this will obviously roll out a little differently this year than it has in the past because of COVID. Tell us what it looks like this year virtually compared to how it's rolled out previous years.
Oh, well, typically we usually celebrate out in a public space, inviting, you know, cultural supports to join and gathering in large numbers. However, we've now seen several organizations move to virtual showcases, which we are doing at the Office of the Treaty Commissioner. And so on Sunday, June 21st, we will be having a virtual showcase. It will be available live on our Facebook page, Office of the Treaty Commissioner, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. However, after the event date, we will have it available on our website for those that are unavailable to join us on Sunday and for those who don't always have access to Facebook. What we're hoping for on that day is to share with the public, you know, the culture, the languages of the Indigenous peoples. We've gathered together elders, knowledge keepers, cultural support, artists, singers, dancers, authors to join us, and they come to us from all across the province, you know, representing the five treaty territories that we have in Saskatchewan and representing the various Indigenous language groups.
Talk about why you would like to see everybody come out and come together to share this experience virtually this time, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous people.
Well, National Indigenous Peoples Day is not only a day for Indigenous people to celebrate. We welcome and encourage full participation from non-Indigenous Canadians. We at the Office of the Treaty Commissioner say we are all treaty people, and we feel that we should celebrate the diversity of our treaty partners together. And so the number of treaties are the foundational building blocks of Canada. And when we recognize our roles and responsibilities as partners, we create safer and more inclusive communities. And so these national days of recognition and the events that highlight and showcase culture and contributions of Indigenous people is enacting those roles and responsibilities associated with our treaty identity.
All right. Can you speak to the importance, of course, of building positive relationships now to counter racism? This is an issue that is top of mind for many right now.
Absolutely. You know, I think the biggest thing with, you know, racism is that it's, you know, misinformation, you know, not enough accurate education. And so what happens is that, you know, systemic racism as a result of laws, you know, that subjugate already, you know, marginalized groups, create, you know, a societal racism. And so what it comes from is that individuals don't have accurate information and they're not, you know, being educated properly. And so what we hope is that through these National Indigenous Peoples Day events and gatherings, more people get an opportunity to see the positive things about Indigenous culture and to share in the beauty of culture and language.
Well, a very important day coming up. I really appreciate you talking about it ahead of time and sharing some of that conversation with us. Thank you so much, Amy.
Absolutely. Thank you for inviting me.
So it is my hope that we will all take some time today to acknowledge, as we are acknowledging the and celebrating the fathers in our lives, to also spend some time today reflecting on National Indigenous Peoples Day and what that might mean for us as treaty people. This is part of National Indigenous History Month. And so one of the things that I'm gonna commit myself to doing, as Amy talked about in the video, that one of the challenges is lack of information, lack of understanding and knowledge. So I have discovered a wealth of information on the Office of the Treaty Commissioner page, as well as various other Facebook groups developed by Indigenous people to help in that process of education. So find something to read or to watch today that can help you to learn a little bit more about what we can do to move towards a deeper sense of real reconciliation, reparation in our relationships with the Indigenous folks in our community.
A reading from Luke, chapter 15, verses 18 through 24. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands. So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion and ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. A reading from Genesis, chapter 22, verses 9 through 14. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the place, The Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, On the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided.
And to reflect on two pretty well-known pieces of scripture that seem to offer to us contrasting images of what it means to be a father. One of the more incredulous stories of the Hebrew Bible speaks about our ancestor Abraham, when he is 99 years old, and his wife Sarah is said to be 90. Despite repeated attempts, they have remained childless throughout their marriage. sitting in front of their tent one day, they observe two unknown strangers coming across the desert in their direction. Exercising the best of Middle Eastern hospitality, they provide for the travelers and invite them to stay overnight with them. As the story unfolds, we discover that these are no ordinary travelers, but are in fact messengers from God. And the message that God has sent to Abraham and Sarah through these two individuals is that they are to be the grandparents, the origins of generations of people who will be known as God's people, who will be known as Israelites. Abraham and Sarah are to be the parents of the nation of Israel. As a result, Sarah is to become pregnant at this ripe age and give birth to their first child, Isaac. This morning's lesson takes place when Isaac is about 10 years old. Abraham and Sarah are surrounded by Canaanite neighbors. They live in the Canaanite neighborhood. And the Canaanites have practices and understandings much different than Sarah and Abraham. They have lived in relative harmony with these neighbors, but they have been influenced by their neighbor's culture, perhaps too influenced. In this morning's story, Abraham has become convinced that he must sacrifice Isaac, his only and first child. Human sacrifice was practiced among the ancient Canaanite tribes, as is described in the Bible's Book of Kings. Perhaps Abraham thought if his neighbor's gods demanded such extreme devotion, that surely he should do the same to please his own God. And so Abraham heads up a mountain with a bundle of wood on his back, a knife in his belt, and Isaac at his side. The modern mind reels before such a prospect. It seems nothing short of absurd that a father, any father, least of all a father who has waited so long for a child, could purposely set out to sacrifice their own child. As one Bible scholar observed, if any modern man thought of such a thing, he would be committed to the hospital, and if he carried it out, he would be sent to jail. Yet before we dismiss Abraham as deranged, let us think for a moment about the nature of human sacrifice over the last century. Do we not know about our grandparents or great-grandparents who, influenced by the circumstances of their culture, allowed or even encourage their children to offer up their lives during the two great wars? Within my own lifespan, I'm aware of how our neighbors to the south committed their sons through the draft, through compulsory enlistment, committed them to the jungles of a distant land to die for a war that they could not win. In the U.S., those who refused to commit their boys were thought of traitors, and the boys who refused to go were branded as criminals. The prevailing ideology of one's neighbors has a tremendous influence on what we judge to be sane or insane behavior. This is Father's Day, and as I approach this Sunday, I felt compelled to hold up the positive images of father love in the same way in which on Mother's Day we speak about mother love. Yet, I was hesitant, restrained by the stories shared too often with me during counseling sessions or pastoral care about fathers who had been inadequate or even violent. This was not my own experience of a father, but it was the experience of some of my parishioners, my clients, and even some of my friends. On the one hand, I wanted today to celebrate the blessings of father love. Yet I could not deny the reality that father love has too often been elusive or completely absent. Why is it more common for mother love to be transparent while father love remains obscure? Why is it easier to have an unapologetic sermon about mothers than it is about fathers? I believe that the clue to this dilemma lies in the story of Abraham. Here is a man who desperately wanted a child, who wanted a son, and seemingly in what looks as if the final attempt, he and his wife were successful. He loved Isaac, and he placed in Isaac all of his hopes and desires for the future, and indeed for future generations. So what was it that made him take all of this love and hope and suppress it, such that he was willing to sacrifice one so dear to him? It would appear that community norms, societal attitudes, religious standards, and peer pressure caused Abraham to ignore his own intuitive wisdom. As we ponder the paradox of father love, it is essential that we recognize the impact that generations of patriarchy have had on fathering. American psychologist Robert Pasek, writing about his therapy with men, concludes that men often live within what he calls a deep sleep. The deep sleep, he writes, is an emotional, cognitive, behavioral state that many men drift into as a consequence of growing up male in this world, and particularly in Western society. Simply stated, Pasek suggests that men are conditioned by society to make work, competition, and success the goal of manhood. Men are taught to ignore their feelings, their relationships with those they love, and even their own intuition. Pasek writes about a 46-year-old male client who related during a therapy session that as a child he had been bitten by a dog. Coming home crying, he remembered his father laughing at him over this incident. His father told him that the dog had bitten him because he showed fear, and he scolded his son, advising him to never let anyone ever know that he was afraid. I have some sympathy for this father, who was, in all likelihood, trying to instill the masculine code in order that his son might survive in the world. Yet Pasek concludes that it is this very masculine code which places men in the deep sleep, which distances men from their emotions and encourages them to sacrifice their most important relationships in order to be validated by the boys. According to Pasek, the code is comprised of the belief that the workplace is more important than the home, that true friendship is but a memory from adolescence, that one should never acknowledge pain or fear or admit that they need the care of others. It appears that Abraham was in a deep sleep, conditioned by his society's masculine code. He had prepared the fire. He had laid Isaac upon a rock. He had drawn his knife. And then Abraham woke up. He woke up. Thank God he woke up. Thank God that God intervened and woke Abraham up to the realization that he had a choice, that he did not need to sacrifice his child, his hope, his future. God woke him up to the reality that he could think and act differently than Abraham did. Perhaps God is always in the practice of trying to wake men up, to wake us up from the deep sleep that causes us to not notice the violence perpetrated upon women, minorities, and one another because of the masculine code. Perhaps the God power is revealing itself in the Me Too movement, in the protests of Black Lives Matter, in men's groups and men's relationships. Perhaps God is always at work trying to upend the masculine code and help us to look away from sacrificing our children to new possibilities. Perhaps God is waking men up to the possibility of being new kinds of fathers and grandfathers, of partners, and of abiding friends. Challenged by these protest movements, disturbed by their own pain, and motivated by their own innate father love, touched by the Holy Spirit, men are coming to embrace themselves, to embrace one another, and to embrace the people they love. More and more men are claiming their place in the parenting of their children. More and more men are resisting the pressures of workaholism and unhealthy competition. One of the most transformative experiences that I've had here at McClure has been the experience of the Saturday morning men's group. This is one of the places where I have seen men share their joys and pains with each other. Around that circle, they share their distress and their worries about their partners, their kids, themselves. They listen carefully and speak thoughtfully, even in the face of raw grief. They celebrate one another's accomplishments, and then they hold hands to pray before they part. This group of men still share the same kind of male camaraderie that wants to tease and laugh and slap one another on the back. But they also are real with one another. For the most part, the men in this circle are mature men who have been exposed to the good and the bad of male culture over their lifetime, and now are consciously choosing the good. Perhaps one of the models for this new manhood was revealed 2,000 years ago. Jesus shared the local culture's view that God was a male, and yet, unlike the generations before him, Jesus did not think of God as a judge or a warrior, or someone to be feared. He taught his friends to call God our Father. And in his most needy moment, Jesus called out, Abba, Daddy. Jesus even gave us a story with a new and transformative image of Father. He described a father who had been challenged by his son, some might even say exploited, a son who had surely been talked about by the neighbors as a disappointment, a failure, a son who others told him to abandon, to forget. Yet this father, Jesus tells us, opens his arms to embrace his son, to assure him that he's always welcome at home, no matter what he has done. He recklessly throws away custom and security in order to throw a party for his returning boy. This prodigal's father is a model of fatherhood that Jesus holds up to every father of every generation. Such a love is reflected in a country western ballad by the country western singer George Strait. Although I listened to CBC radio all week trying to get the news and the insight, I have to confess that on weekends I secretly turned to the country channel. Admittedly, this song by George Strait is a little simplistic, but as I thought about his words, I mused about how this song rose up in the charts on a radio station that is most often listened to by farmers and farmhands, by ranchers and roughnecks, by truckers, and it appears even the occasional preacher. Such affirmation of these words is a sign to me that the masculine code is indeed losing impact and being replaced by real men who can speak about real love for their children, their partners, and others. And so in conclusion, I'd like to share the lyrics of this song. I won't attempt to sing it. As I suggest, it's a bit simplistic, and yet when you think of the context in which it is being heard, it is for me a sign of hope. Here are the words. He sings, "I got sent home from school one day with a shiner on my eye. Fighting was against the rules, and it didn't matter why. When Dad got home, I told that story just like I'd rehearsed, then stood there on my trembling knees and waited for the worst. And Dad said, 'Let me tell you a secret about a father's love, a secret that my daddy said was just between us.' He said, 'Daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end. Amen. It's a love without end. Amen.' When I became a father in the spring of 81, there was no doubt that stubborn boy was just like my father's son. And when I thought my patience had been tested to the end, I took my daddy's secret and passed it on to him. Daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end. Amen.' In the final verse, 'Last night I dreamed I'd died and stood outside those pearly gates, when suddenly I realized there must be some mistake. If they knew half the stuff I'd done, they'd never let me in. Then somewhere from the other side, I heard those words again. Daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end. Amen. It's a love without end. Amen.' Might all men, sons of the living and loving God, come home to themselves and be blessed by the loves of their life on this Father's Day. Amen.
Good morning. Let us pray. God, you teach us that for your kingdom to come, for your dream for us to come true, we must actively sow the seeds of love, however small and vulnerable. And so, God, this morning, hear our prayers of love for you, ourselves, and for our neighbors. We pray with love, O God, and give you thanks for creation, for the beauty of the sky, the richness of the soil, the life-giving gift of rain, and the warm sun that urges growth and abundance. When we forget the fragility, the vulnerability, and the sanctity of this, our garden home, remind us, correct us, and set us on the path of awareness and good stewardship once again. We pray with love for all of us, those of Treaty 6 and the homeland of the Métis, for the challenges of the truth and reconciliation work still to be done, for those who are still sharing stories of their experience of residential schools in hope that in sharing the pain, they will inspire healing and change. And for those of the 60 Scoop still telling the stories of resilience and persistence in hope that in sharing, they will inspire healing and change. And for those who are listening to these difficult stories and who are charged with the work of making a difference, we ask that there might be courage in partnership to act now. We pray with love for all of us who live with the heavy burden of racism, for those for whom the color of their skin or their ethnicity is a barrier to resources, respect, and fair treatment, and for those who are working hard to uncover deep-seated racist attitudes and are seeking new ways of being in the world, may the holy anger found here in the struggle against racism bubble into true equity and justice. We pray with love for all of the LGBT plus community. In this month of Pride, we celebrate the great privilege and gift it is to love and be loved. We pray for gentleness and grace for those still exploring their sexual identity. And we pray that they might find the beauty that you have created them to be. And where injustice and homophobia still exist, we pray for courage and strength to stand in solidarity with one another to make change. We pray with love for the men in our community and in the world who are entrusted with the care and nurture of children and who take up that responsibility with a deep and a tender love. For fathers and uncles, brothers and friends who teach the way of grace, gentleness, and integrity, we give you thanks, Abba God. For young men struggling with society's mixed messages about what it means to be a real man, we ask for your guidance and your wisdom. And for those who have been hurt by the men in their lives, we ask that a path of healing be found. We pray with love for all who are ill, for all who are struggling with medical treatments and the impact illness has upon family and friends. We pray for those who mourn the loss of a loved one, and for those for whom the world is a lonely place. We ask that all might know healing and the assuring warmth of your love. Hear, O God, these our prayers of love, however small, and help them grow into acts of reconciliation, justice, kindness, and compassion, so that your kingdom might be known in this place and in the world. We pray with love, together, the prayer given to Jesus' disciples. Our Father and Mother who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Wherever you may go, I will follow, and your people shall be my people too. Wherever you may go, I will follow, for I would be faithful, loyal, and true. Say the word and I will stay. Shall be my people too. Wherever you may go, I will follow, for I would be faithful, loyal, and true. From beginning to the end, I will always be your friend. When you need me, I'll be there. Trust my faithful care. Wherever you may go, I will follow, and your people shall be my people too. Wherever you may go, I will follow, for I would be faithful.
And now, friends, we go into the world of complexity and challenge with the message of God's love in our hearts. And so we go trusting that the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit is ours today and every day. We go. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Thank you.